Pleasant Green Missionary Baptist Church, 540 West Maxwell Street, Lexington, Kentucky. We bring you greetings from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. For Jesus Christ is on the throne and Jesus rules in our hearts. So we need to be glad about it. For this day has the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the Reverend Ron Jones, Associate Minister here at this grand old place. For God is spirit, and those that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. As we start out this worship period, we are here with our musician, our own brother, Maren Shockley, who will bring us music from on high where we can rejoice and praise our Lord.
Because of what the Lord has done. done for us. Give thanks. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks for He has given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks for He has given Jesus Christ, His Son. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. Just give thanks. Oh Lord, yeah, yeah, oh Lord, give thanks. Give thanks.
Brothers and sisters, our scriptures for this period, for this hour of worship, it is taken from the Johannine Gospel, the Gospel according to John, chapter 8, verses 1 through 9. And it reads as follows. Jesus went unto the Mount of Olives, and early in the morning, he came again into the temple, and all the people came unto him. And he sat down and taught them. And the scribes and the Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Now Moses and the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what says thou? And this they said, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and with his finger wrote on the ground, as though he heard them not. And so when they continue asking him, he lifted up himself and said unto them, He that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. And again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. And they which heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning at the eldest, even until the last. And Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. May the Lord have a blessing to the reading and hearing of His holy and divine word. My brothers and my sisters, just for a brief period, we want to concentrate on this thought from John chapter 8, verses 1 through 9. And the thought is, when God stoops, when God stoops. When you look at the gospel according to John, chapter 6, Jesus is the bread of life. When you look at chapter 7, Jesus is the living water. And now when you look at chapter 8, Jesus calls himself, refers to himself as the light of the world. Come with me and use your sanctified mind just for a little while. There are times when majesty on high stoops down to our level. Use your sanctified mind. Using anthropomorphic language. God stooped down to form man out of the dust of the ground. God stooped down to smell the sweet smell and savor behind the Holy of Holies during the Old Testament. God stooped down, best of all, when his only begotten son was at the cross at Calvary, offering himself. He bore our sin on himself. And the Father stooped down to smell the sweet smelling savor that was presented to him by his only begotten son. So there are times when God stoops down. Now, sometimes when God stoops down, he likes to write with his fingers. And I know God doesn't have fingers. So that's why I stated a second ago using anthropomorphic language to help us kind of identify with the process. God used his fingers, according to the scriptures, to write the Ten Commandments, or the Decalogue, or the oracles, if you will, on stone. God used his hand and his fingers to write on the walls. When you go back to Daniel chapter 5, he disrupted a party that was held by the son of King Nebuchadnezzar. He disrupted this party because his father took silver and fine vessels out of the temple and brought them back to Babylon. But his son paid no respect to these vessels that came out of the temple. He used them while he held this party. So God wrote on the walls to get his attention. And there's another time where we see here in our text where majesty on high, God manifested in flesh. Jesus once again stoops down and once again, like he did in the past, wrote a message on a medium. Now, when you look here at this text, the leaders bought this woman caught in the very act of adultery in order to trick Jesus to see will he contradict himself against the teaching of the law. But the people forget that Jesus is the continuation. He is the fulfillment of the law. I know you have to be wondering. Well, it takes two to commit adultery. They brought the woman to Jesus. But where is the man? According to the Mishnah, the codification of Jewish law, the Mishnah states that the woman should be stoned, as they were about to do here in our text, but the man should be placed in a pit and strangled to death. But they brought this woman to Jesus to see what will he say to them. Jesus, the master, wrote on the ground. And he said, he that is without sin cast a stone at her. Jesus did not condemn this woman, because by his own words, Jesus was the only one there. Jesus, the only one that walked on this earth that qualifies to cast a stone at this lady, because he's the only one without sin. So when he made this statement, according to the scriptures, from the oldest down to the least of them, went away. Once again, use your sanctified mind. I don't know. The scripture doesn't tell us whether the people, the Pharisees and the scribes, dropped their stones one by one, or whether they took their stones with them for another occasion. Well, when God forgives us of our sins, there are times where God takes our sins one by one. And there are other times where God allows us to wrestle with our sin. As he told Peter, his beloved apostle, when thou art converted, strengthen your brothers. Sometimes God allows us to be converted, not from the sense of sanctification, but from the sense of being converted, overcoming that obstacle in our life, overcoming that problem, that sin in our lives. Now, when Jesus sets us free, when Jesus stoops down to cleanse us, when Jesus stoops down to wipe us off, when Jesus stoops down to dry our tears, when Jesus stoops down to save us, this is the only process where I know where God allows himself to stoop down in order for us to be bought up. It's the Lord stooping down in order so that we can be raised up. When Jesus touches us, and when Jesus once again does some writing. Well, what writing are you talking about, preacher? There's times where God writes on our hearts. There are times where God would take his finger, using anthropomorphic language, and put his name on our heart. Therefore, when the Father sees us, he doesn't really see merely us, but he sees the Son's mark, his only begotten mark, his only begotten finger, his only begotten Son's writing on our hearts. So when he looks at us, he sees that the Son has stooped down to raise us up. The Son stoops down to cleanse us. Has God ever stooped down? And has God ever took his divine finger? And has God ever took his finger to write on your heart? And what he writes on our heart is his own name, being saved by my blood. And when we are saved by the blood of Jesus, nothing can condemn us. For the scripture says, who can lay a charge against God's elect? Because Jesus done made us whole. By stooping down, he done made us whole. So when God stoops down in our life, you have to understand that he has set us free. Sin is a burden, just like the stones that these folks were carrying. These stones has some weight to them. Sin has weight to it. Sin can weigh you down. Sin can wear you out. Sin can take the joy out of your life. But when Jesus comes, Jesus has a way to lighten the load. For the scripture says, in Gospel according to Matthew, around the 11th chapter, where he says, take my yoke upon you. Paraphrasing, he said, take my load, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So when you take on the Lord's way, he will lighten your load, because he will take sin and replace it with his love. He will take sin and replace it with his grace. When Jesus comes our way, and when Jesus stoops down, and when Jesus places his fingers on us, we are truly indeed saved. If you've been saved, you should know it in your heart. It should not be any doubt. It should not be any kind of confusion. You should know when the Lord has came into your heart and changed it. Now, the scripture says way back in Ezekiel that he's going to take out the stony heart. You know, those stones that represent our faith in God. We think that he wrote the Ten Commandments on stone due to a durability concept. No, he wrote it on stone to identify with the people's heart. I'm going to write these words on stone because your heart looks like stone to me. Well, that's why he said, I'm going to take this heart of yours, this heart made out of stone, and I'm going to replace it with a heart of flesh. So this fleshly heart will be sensitive to my word. This fleshly heart will be sensitive to my spirit. But when he puts this heart of flesh in us, that means that we are his. And only God can do this. Only God can perform this surgery. Now, usually, surgery requires anesthesia. It requires us to take a sleep. But I don't remember falling asleep when God transformed my life. So when he takes the stone and when he replaces it with his love and with his grace, that's what he's doing. He is transforming us. He's changing our minds. He's changing our hearts. He's changing the way we walk in life. He's changing the way we view life. He's changing us completely. Now, this change doesn't happen overnight. It is a continual process, but it's a process that will keep going until we are glorified. And thanks be to God, he's the only one that can perform this feat. Thanks be to God, once we are saved indeed. We talk about the gospel according to John, where Jesus made a lot of statements that he is, or I ams. Gospel according to John is noted for the I ams made by Jesus. Well, guess what? Later on, he said, I am the good shepherd, for these sheep are mine. And these sheep the Father has given me. And once the Father has placed these sheep in my hand, no man can pluck them out, because I and the Father are one. So once we are saved, and once we have been born again from the Spirit, we are saved indeed. Yes, we are. So if you want this saving act, if you want the Spirit of God to come into your life, you have to first acknowledge that he is God, that he is the true and living God. As Proverbs teach us, the first step to wisdom is to acknowledge that God is. So you have to understand that all man is sinners, and God is the only one that can set us free. So we pray that you will find these words enriching. We pray that you will find these words enlightening. We pray that you will, if you not have been changed by the Spirit of God, we pray that you will allow the Spirit of God to come into your heart. Preachers cannot save you. Your mother and father cannot save you. For salvation or grace, we cannot inherit. You have to be, you must be, you gotta be born again. So we pray that you ask the Father, because in the same gospel, Jesus said, no man could come to me unless the Father draws him. The Father is the one of the Godhead who does the electing. He is the one that places us in Jesus Christ. You have to be born again. You must be in the loving arms of God. And God is the only one that can save us. Look at it like this. By his death, he saved us. But you know what? He lives again. And you know what? Since he lives again, if his death saves us, then him living again shall keep us. So he rose up on that third and appointed day. And you know what? He got up with full power. Well, some may say, well, we thought he always had power. He is the creating agent of the triune God. That is right. He always had power. But this time he's saying it as the resurrected Messiah. So we pray that you will come to know Christ. May the Lord bless you and may the Lord enrich you. Now, we pray that you give your hearts over to the Lord, for salvation comes by no other way. And we are here, we have this coronavirus, this C-19 has not stopped the spirit of the living God. So we say that if you have a concern about spiritual matter and you want to seek Christ, call here, call this number, 254-7387. And we'll be glad, we'll be tickled pink because we joy over you. The scripture says, when a sinner repents, the angels in heaven rejoice, and we rejoice. We'll be tickled pink. Not because we have the virus, but we'll be tickled pink because we are rejoicing and overcome with the Spirit. May God bless you and God keep you. We praise you. For every blessing comes from you on high. We do not put the blessing above the one who gave us the blessing. For as David said, I will rejoice in the Lord my Savior. David said, for he is good and he is rich in mercy. David said, I will take thy word and hide it in my heart so I may not sin against thee. David understood that the law wasn't just merely words, but it's a walk with you. So we want to walk with you, Lord, and we want to commune with you each and every day. Now, receive the benediction. Grace, mercy, truth,